So shall we begin? Even though the number is very small just now, I think we have to start. It's been 6 minutes after three. And you did notice that I've made a mistake in referring to the case we're supposed to discuss today as that of Janwadi Mahila Samiti, but it's All India Democratic Women's Association versus UNIDA. So did you get a chance to read that today?
Yes, ma'am.
You haven't? It's just a one-page case in any case. Have the others read? Hina, Prakriti, Karthik, Kushal. Kushal, how do you pronounce your name?
It's Kushal.
Kushal. So yes, Kushal, ma'am. Did you read your case?
No, ma'am, not today.
Did you read the other reading on domestic violence?
No, ma'am. Actually, I was going through that lawyer's reading yesterday, which you have given. So mm-hmm. I was going through the whole reading.
Okay. So what did you discover?
So, ma'am, there were sexual abuse cases, domestic violence cases, sexually abusive cases, and where the court has not given the right judgment.
Which one are you referring to?
Ma'am, wait, I'll let you know in a while. Let me open the document.
What about the others? You have done any of the either the
five such people have joined the ma'am, I have done the reading also.
There's some confusion about the class.
That other people have joined another group of yours, the earlier link. So they are joining that.
Yeah, I said ignore that one.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Maybe they would not have sent the latest email.
I have WhatsApped in the group. They'll mm-hmm. be joining.
Okay. Yes, I was just wondering why the number was so small today. Now we are coming up. So yeah, those of you who joined, you have read the readings for today. Despite the confusion I created by referring to the case as Janwadi Mahila rather than All India Democratic Association, Women's Association. So which one should we take up first?
Ma'am, the case.
All India Women's.
Okay. So what it is about?
This case is basically about wherein a place in Junjunu, Rajasthan, there was the practice of, so it was in question that whether that there was a religious ceremony, which was the Chunari ceremony, which was taking place in some mandir in the state of Rajasthan, and it was in question that whether this ceremony is a glorification of sati or not. And there was another dispute regarding that whatever the collections or the income generated by the temple of it will, so the court ordered that this the income would be should be deposited in a nationalized bank, and the further and the it went to the Supreme Court, like the case went to the Supreme Court. So the Supreme Court did not mention or say, they said that whether the particular ceremony, because the council contended that this is not a practice relating to the glorification of sati, which was prohibited under the sati under the act. It was a traditional practice. And the other parties obviously contend that it's a part of the glorification of sati only, and the Chunari ceremony, particularly in the state of Rajasthan, was related to the sati practices only. So the court said that we will look into this in a later stage. Mm-hmm. And they directed that the income which was generated, it should be spent on the maintenance of the temple premises.
Mm-hmm. And also, and any monies to be given for charities?
Charity. And so the council contended that the particular premises should be set up as rehabilitation centers. So the court said that there's no provision as to so to change the nature of that particular premises. But yes, we will say that whatever amount is being going to the charity, it will be continuing to be do so. It will mm-hmm. be continued, and that fund and the income to be released, and it can be spent in the maintenance of the temple premises.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So anybody who has a thought on this case, what do you think? What is good about this case? What is not so good about this case? What have we learned from the perspective of domestic violence and prohibition of the bad evil practices we have against women in the domestic relationships? Shavi has given
good summary.
Yes, Shavi?
Ma'am, while I was reading it, so one of the two, there was two issues raised, but I don't know why the court did not, because the other party contended that the ceremony is a practice related to sati, but I don't know why the court has not focused on that, or there's no, they said it at a later stage.
What is the nature of this case? Is it an SLP? Is it that an SP? What is it?
It was a civil miscellaneous petition. So yeah, matlab, I didn't read.
It's a preliminary. It's a preliminary hearing.
Yes.
So it is not a final disposition of the case.
Yes.
It's a miscellaneous criminal application. That one. So once you have a preliminary hearing, so the preliminary hearing is not on the substantive really. The issue was whether the prohibition on the money to be used should be permitted or it should be released, because only the small matter was referred. So this was not the stage where they have gone on in appeal to the Supreme Court on merit of the case.
Yes.
So it was the order granted by the High Court, and the small part of it that no, there should be the total collection, the donation amount should be seized and should not be permitted to be used. They said at least in the interim, allow us to use it for the two purposes. One for the maintenance of the temple, and the second one was for the whatever charities they were running to continue giving them. So therefore, both the thing, that whether Chunri ceremony is a religious, is other social practice unconnected with Sati or not, that was not the issue before the Supreme Court. So they could not have. They were not expected, they were not required to deal with that issue at that point of time, because if they were to express any opinion on this in this one, and the matter goes back to the High Court, because the matter is still pending in the High Court.
Yes.
So there was certainly, they said, no, it will hamper, it will kind of influence the High Court's viewpoint on this one. Therefore, we will not express any opinion on that matter. Anyone who has a knowledge about this Chunri ceremony, what happens in Chunri ceremony? And in which temples is the ceremony offered? Anyone from Rajasthan, any idea who has this knowledge? And I think Shavi did point out the important thing that what we have learned from this case is basically very clearly that the existing Sati temples have not to be converted. That is not part of the legal procedure. They will remain at the Sati temples. So what is it that has been prohibited by the law is any practice which will be leading to glorification. So day-to-day prayers, the day-to-day opening of the temple is not seen as glorification. So the judge, it is not in so many words, but very typically, the judges have taken the viewpoint that just because there's a temple and everyday prayers happens, that is not glorification. So what is glorification then? Glorification is seen as only when there's a special occasions being created. So in everyday temple, when you go, when we go to the temple and make prayers, etc., this is a routine matter. This is not glorification. But when we say, no, a special occasion, this birthday, that jayanti, those something, and no special focus is there. Because every day you may go to a Ram temple, but on Ram Navami there will be a special occasion there. So therefore, when we are doing these special occasions where a lot more people visit the temple than on a regular basis, then that's what the judges are saying. That's what, I mean, they understand. There's no specific explanation of that. And so there are two things. One, whether this particular ceremony is glorification or not. And I'm extending that question to a discussion that when we are talking about in the Sati Prohibition Act, so what will be the kind of activities which will amount to glorification? And I think Ankit, or who was Karthi, who was taking that? No, I forget now whether who was raising that question earlier, that there was this MP who was asking for donations and doing everything around that. So when you are kind of certainly giving praises and in the name of this Sati you're asking for donation, etc., all those will be. So I don't think it will be only limited to a special occasion, but also if you make a special occasion out of maybe sometime, you know, somebody's birthday, and you say, okay, we want to have a party, or not party in the same sense, but we have a big havan or a yagya or a big puja on that occasion, all these activities will amount to in that head. Any other thoughts? Yes, no, maybe? So, okay, we can move on to the second reading. Who has read that reading? And I don't think Shabi should be the only one who has read that. There should be other people also have read. Who else has read domestic violence in gay relationships? So how do we, I think the first question this reading does raise is, how do we visualize and conceptualize a gay relationship? Is it only a sexual relationship, or there is more to that relationship?
Ma'am, there is certainly more things attached to this relationship, mm-hmm. emotional, psychological, other than physical relationship. Mm-hmm. So, all in all, we have not recognized that there can be violence, domestic violence in gay relationships.
Mm-hmm.
So, we do not have the system in place in order to arrange for advocacy programs or counseling services for people who are the victim of these domestic violence acts.
Mm-hmm. This article that we're talking about is written in which year? Do we have the citation in this one or no? This is this soon after 95. It's an old article. And if you look at who is the writer, can you see?
Najel C. Christie.
Who is he? How he describes it as a BA Bakato, LLB first class honors Bakato. Somebody has to switch off their mic. I'm getting an echo. Okay. I think it's okay now. So, and also he is a DPhil candidate. He's done all these the other degrees and School of Law. It's a research scholar aspirant who has written this. and it is soon after 1995. And this is writing about which country?
New Zealand.
Is it New Zealand? So in New Zealand in 1995, they had recognized certain kind of relationships in the gay relationships, or certain more progressive legislation there in that country. And at that point of time, they were saying, because they're saying Domestic Violence Act recognized. But then to what extent, and also prior to that, the history in New Zealand legislation does say that previously the relationship was decriminalized. So we are at that stage, that we have decriminalized homosexuality, consensual homosexuality relationships. But have we recognized any other rights, obligations, duties among gay partners? Can they have a right of residence? Can they have a right to maintenance? Can they have a right against domestic violence? Do we even think of gay relationships as relationships, or whether these are just sexual interactions people have? So this is the stage where the article is still talking about what we are dealing with today, 2 decades ago in New Zealand. So even though their law decision has become to recognize that there is violence, there is a possibility, but still the setups were still not completely open, were not integrating the gay sexual violence, gay domestic violence. So gay sexual violence is different from domestic violence in gay relationship. What will be the difference?
I think in the heterosexual relationship of domestic violence, so there is basically of the like long ongoing, because of the patriarchy and what is the mindset, it's been going that there is a dominant male figure and then there's a subservient woman. So like mm-hmm. he is the one like he's violating and he's the perpetrator, wherein mm-hmm. even in this article he has mentioned that if we try to fit that heterosexual relationship into a gay relationship, it would not be okay, because the things are very different. So there is as such no dominance. It can be different. There is no dominant and then a submissive figure. They may be, but not like generally it is not there.
Mm-hmm.
The power control and the power, the periphery of power and the power dynamics, so to say. But it may not be like in all cases.
Right. So I think somewhere what this article challenges us to rethink and think more clearly about is that what is the nature of homosexual relationships? Are these limited only to the homosexual of the sexual nature, and therefore the violence in the sexual interaction is one kind of violence, which may happen even without what we call as the domestic relationship between partners. There might be a casual fling and there might be sexual violence in that scenario. The other one is that the domestic violence, when we look at the Protection of Women Against Domestic Violence Act, it is not limited only to sexual violence. Sexual violence is one category of domestic violence. In gay relationships, if we think of them as a couple, when we use the word couple, we usually in our mind think of a male and a female there. But when we're talking about the homosexual couple, we are talking about two men or two women who are in a long-term committed relationship. So there might be the unmarried couple, there might be the dating couple, there might be the married couples. So there might be the whole range of people who are committed in different degrees to each other. So when it's a long-term commitment, and if there is violence in that, how do we fit it into the structure of domestic violence? So one way to look at it will be to put it in the same category as the domestic violence in heterosexual relationship. Heterosexual relationships are very categorical, patriarchal. So there is this dominant male and there is the subservient woman. What is the nature of the gay relationship? Whether the gay relationship is also that there is, because when you go back to our earlier discussion on the whole range of sexual relationships in which there might be two men, you know, the men having sex with men. So that the MSM was only limited to sexual part of it. But we also noticed in that discussion on gender and sex distinction when we were dealing with it, that the nature of sexual relationship between the same sex partners may be different both among women and men. Some of the relationship may have one who is much more masculine and the other who is much more feminine in this, on the same sense as we have looked at the heterosexual relationships. But there may be many others who do not fit, and in fact, they are not at all interested in having a parallel or a replication of the same structure in the same-sex relationship also. And therefore, so that's one aspect of it, that it is not necessary that the gay couple is necessarily hierarchical. They may be hierarchical, they may not be hierarchical. And merely because some of them are hierarchical does not mean that the others have to be dealt in the same manner, or they would have the same power dynamics, because in the hierarchical structure, we say the dominant one beats up the other, or dominates and overpowers and do whatever, you know, whatever undesirable conduct that the person does. But when it is not a hierarchical relationship, will there be no violence? Is that an assumption? And that's what this article is challenging, that there cannot be no assumption that if there is no hierarchy, there will be no violence. When you look at the violence per se outside the domestic relationships, there is a lot of violence. There's not necessarily any hierarchy when people, two men fight on the roads. It's not hierarchical situation as a starting point. So there might be a lot of reasons because of which in a non-hierarchical structure also there might be violence. So that's one point. The second one is that why domestic violence in gay relationship has not been seen as an issue. So anyone? I want to take a 30-second break. So I'm back. Yeah. So what do you think? What is why this has not been considered? Why has it not emerged as an issue? I don't think, Karthik, we will need to open another link. They should continue till the whole duration. I've paid subscription for the same. Hopefully. Yeah, so tell me, why do you think this has not come to the fore, domestic violence in, as per the article?
Ma'am, so the author states two reasons for this. The first would be, as Chavi pointed out, that the domestic relationship, in our opinion, has always been a male and a female figure. And that is why we could not wrap our minds around the idea that two males could be in a domestic relationship. And the second one would be that
if we could not picture two males being in a domestic relationship, then we could not actually think beyond that point, that if they are, in our eyes, if they did not exist as couples, so there would be no domestic violence. And we always think that domestic violence always occurs between a person who's strong and a person who's weak. So one would be submissive and one would be dominant. But when we take two gay males in a relationship, we cannot think that one would be weak and one would be strong. But the actual notion is that even in the gay relationships, one person is dominant and the other person is submissive. So naturally, when this occurs, so there would be conflict of opinions and there would be domestic violence. So this is what the author says, the two reasons that we don't think that domestic violence would occur in between gay couples.
Yeah, so one, of course, is this whole understanding of whether there is a domestic relationship between gay partners or whether this is just a sexual union. Then the second one, okay, does any one of us in this class know any gay couple? I'm not asking you to identify any, but do you know anyone personally who is a gay couple?
Yes, ma'am, I do.
Okay, how many of us, anybody who has got known as either gay or lesbian? I'm using gay
as inclusive.
So a couple of us know that. How long they have been in the relationship?
Almost 10 years now.
Right. So, but most of us, do we think when we talk about gay relationships or same-sex relationships, do we think in terms of 10 years, 20 years, the whole lifetime? Those of us who have never met anybody in the relationship.
Ma'am, the article talks about that the first thing is the acceptance. So to file a complaint, they have to come out.
Yeah, so that was the point I was making, that even though in this class two people have said that they know somebody, there may be many more among our colleagues, our friends, who may be in those relationships, but they're not coming out. So unless they first, you know, and we know the consequences are coming out till the update. And Singh Johar's case, it was illegal to come out. Now that it has become legal, the social stigma still stays. Most of us are not comfortable with meeting people who are not the same heterosexual preferences as we think is normal. A lot of us still think it is abnormal. It is unnatural. So given that social perception and social stigma and legal consequences still very recently, the possibility of somebody coming out is a huge burden, because for them to complain that there is a domestic violence against me in my relationship, he or she will have to first say, I am in a same-sex relationship. So that's an important point which the article makes, and Vivek has brought this out, that most of the time, so one is that they are in a relationship. The other is that how many people we know are open gay and open lesbian. We know very few, exceptionally. So we are not talking here of the transgender persons, you know, those which have identified a couple in our faculty. But the other group of the same-sex relationship, nobody has come out in the open to say that I am in that relationship. So we do not know, unless there may be a personal chances for us to know them. They are not out there openly. So the two people, the couple or whoever the person which two of our class fellows have identified that they know, do they know that this fact at a personal level, or they're openly out there? Is there, you know, the stages of coming out? So some people come out to immediate family, some people come out to only family, some people come out only to, you know, some family members other than their parents, some come out to just some friends, some come out completely openly to everybody else. So depending on which stage of your own understanding of yourself, acceptance of yourself is, the reporting of domestic violence is a second hurdle. So in the heterosexual relationships, it is widely recognized that domestic violence exists. Even then, there are so many obstacles to the woman reporting. So many psychological barriers, so many social obstructions, so many legal no absence of empathy in the legal systems. So because of all that, even in heterosexual relationship, it is very difficult for women to come out and report that. It is much more difficult in a same-sex relationship. Because in that one, first of all, to be accepted as being in a same-sex relationship itself is a burden. Then to say, oh, I'm also being, oh, even in this relationship, I'm being battered. So why are you in this relationship? So it's a double burden there. So what else, Vivek? What else has this article said? What is the second? What is another obstacle?
Ma'am, second is Maslow's hierarchy. So first, they want to have in the society a good name of the community itself. In the community, yes. Even if they know, they want to hide it because they want the relationship to be taken seriously in the society. And right. If they bring this kind of topic in the society, the relationship, which is considered to be a deviant relationship, it will get much more worse name.
So it is not a personal thing alone. So in this one, they are not saying that me alone. They're looking at the whole community, interest of the whole community. That a whole, everybody will be kind of then stigmatized. You know, you bring out one case and the whole community will be stigmatized. So the moment we do that, you know, there's a minority. One person does anything wrong, everybody in that minority is kind of put into the same class, what we call a stereotype. Or these people are like this only. So therefore, that is a community interest also because of which they may not report. Yes?
Third thing, ma'am, you already said that they are in the same relation, right? So the author wrote about, if he comes out also, the law agencies, right, they are not equipped to understand that, means the concept of counseling. And for a man to come out and say about domestic violence in itself comes out like he is not enough manly.
Yeah.
So the system itself is not put in around for the support for him. So maybe the law is there, but the counseling piece is missing.
Yeah, this is kind of in New Zealand, this law is there. But in India, we don't have even that law. We are not at that stage. So even in the country where they did make a law, but to say that I need counseling, I am the one who is being harassed, is to say I'm not man enough. Because the construction of masculinity is still there. Men are supposed to be in control of things. They're supposed to be able to protect themselves. They're supposed to protect not only themselves, but also others. And here is a man who says, oh, I can't protect even myself. So then the question of no self, that who am I? Am I a man? Am I not a man? So that also pressurizes people not to report. So even if they report, whether the counselors are trained sufficiently to deal with that situation, because that, you know, in our curricula, the same way we do in a law faculty, we don't talk about gender. So whether in counseling, will there be counselors who will be prepared, first of all, at their own mental level, to be non-biased in giving counseling to a gay, to a person in a same-sex relationship? So their own, the whole system, the whole disciplines are so gendered, so binary. Most of the disciplines, when talking about social work, social sciences, sociology, we have all been trained to look at the human population in the binary of men and women. So when you, and men and women and heterosexual sexual relationships. So once we have been trained to look at people in that from that perspective, and if we are then say we ourselves as the experts in the subject are biased, not necessarily knowingly, but at the unconscious level, then this person who goes for counseling may not actually get the right kind of counseling, but they again feel alienated as well. So the systems are not there. People are not there, and there is an inherent limitations of the person and of the image of the community itself also. There are lots of obstacles there. So what should be done? Any other thing about this article that you want to highlight?
Ma'am, one thing this article talked about is like when we talked about domestic violence, it's only about the physical aspect which people are able to understand clearly. The aspect which is about verbal, emotional and economical abuse and the power to control and manipulate. Mm-hmm. It is very difficult for people to understand, and it is not limited to gender. It can be a question of power between people, the interplay.
Yeah.
So it is not related, and that's why even author asks, even the lesbian community to look into it, mm-hmm. whether they have a similar kind of thing or not, because he just focused only on this one group. So the part where it is economical, emotional and verbal abuse, it is very difficult.
Yeah. And I think because now that we have, if we were to follow on similar patterns as the domestic violence act 2005, we would hope that the same range of domestic abuse and domestic violence will be recognized as and when we move in that direction. But before, you know, because when we talk about changes in the law, what are the mechanisms because of which changes can be brought in? There has to be either an elite, either the legislature, somebody in the legislature who kind of takes up this issue, or there should be a sufficient lobby group for the political parties to think it's in their interest, what interest to make that law, or somebody does believe this is, you know, somebody in power who has the position to bring a law, maybe push through that law. So in our country at this point of time, what are we struggling with in cases of same-sex relationships? What stage are we at?
I think it is coming out. So the coming out of coming out as a gay couple, it's very difficult. So that person, the gay couple, they have come out as they have built tremendous courage to finally come out as come out as a gay couple. But then there is also that they also the problem that they'll be outed. They'll be the others.
Yeah,
they'll be not in the normal category or in the normal category of male or female, and also the stereotype which is attached that to the gay couples and to the gays.
The usage of the male and female in this context is not necessarily most appropriate, but they might be seen as male female, but certainly absurd and abnormal. That's what they the homophobia. Yeah. That these are very absurd people.
Yes, ma'am. And the stereotype which is attached that a gay person is he's less masculine and a more feminine than a heterosexual man, which may not be the trait which many of the gay couples or the gay would strive to achieve in that in their personal. So there's a stereotype that they are more feminine.
Mm-hmm.
These stereotypes is attached, and when we come talk about violence, so in the article it says that many women they don't consider themselves as abuse victims. Mm-hmm. So there is another situation in gay scenarios, not much different. So because for them it is like there is a complete voidness, and there is a question of that if they'll admit that they have been subjected to violence, it will make them less of a man. So this question is always revolving around.
Right. So now how do we sum up our discussion on domestic violence?
I think it is not about the sexual orientation or the gender identity of the people involved in a relationship. It is more about their emotional understanding, their psychological understanding. And domestic violence and abuse involves a lot more aspects than physical aspect. And also there is a need to sensitize the society, especially in India, where we are still on the very initial stages of gaining civil rights.
Mm-hmm.
And also the transgender bill, which talks about discrimination and abuse, sexual abuse, violence and everything. It does not discuss about the LGB community, that is lesbian, gay and bisexual.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a long way to go till these people attain some rights and can come out freely and make the society recognize their rights.
Yeah, so what we are finding is that when we talk about violence in domestic sphere, it is not limited only to the, you know, the hierarchical categories of men and women, where most of the time it is the male who is causing violence to the woman. It is happening even when there are two women, when there are two men in a long-term relationship. Violence may still happen. So why does this violence happen? Because we have accepted violence as a means of settling disputes ourselves. Law for a long time has been saying, no violence among yourselves. If you have a problem, come to us. This is what the state says. If at all some violence has to be caused, I will cause that violence. The state will cause that violence. The state will cause that violence in terms of death penalty, in terms of punishments, the whole range of them, from fine to imprisonment to anything. So whatever, whether it is, recently we had these riots and names of people were put out there that they were involved in riots in UP. So that is what you call a defaming. The defamation was being done by the state itself. So whatever has to be done, whatever justifiable, I'm not getting into the question of whether it was justifiable or not. They're saying that all the punishments do cause some kind of harm to the person, and that's the purpose of the punishment itself also. But that harm has to be done by the state after following due process. So the state has been constantly been saying, when we created the state, we said, in order to prevent violence, we are creating the state. We want everybody to be treated equal. But we as people have not accepted that norm in our domestic relationships. We continue to be governed by understanding that in the public sphere, we're all equal. We need to be civil. But when it comes to the private sphere, I am the boss, whoever that right boss might be. We do not think that we are all there as equals in the domestic relationship. We are all there to support each other. So that norm at the social level is not accepted because of the patriarchal nature of the family of the majority people. So the same value still continues in the private sphere. I can do what I want to. Other people have been doing it, I will also do it. I'm quite sure that the same gay person will not use violence in the public sphere to other person in similar circumstance. So we think that it is okay. Yes.
Ma'am, I would request everybody to go and see a movie called Milk.
Mm-hmm.
It's based on the life of a person named Harvey Milk, who is the first elected gay person in US.
Mm-hmm.
And he worked hard for the getting rights for the gay community. When I say gay community, it's all LGBT. But in the private life, he was doing himself domestic violence.
Yes.
It's a very good movie. It's an Oscar. I think Sean Penn got an Oscar for his role also.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yeah, so that's what the point is, that we all still are so much governed by the private-public dichotomy. When we started this course, we started with our understanding of that there is this whole understanding in the legal system and in our private spheres, in our personal viewpoints as well, that there are certain things which is possible to be done in the private sphere, which is a complete no-no in the public sphere. So it is not only law. We as human beings, we are so ingrained with that thinking that in the private sphere, some amount of violence is acceptable. And unless we challenge that norm, that whatever norms of civil behavior you form in the community outside your house, the same norm has to be governing your personal lives as well. It cannot be settled by beating each other in the private sphere, just because you're related, either by blood or by marriage or whatever that relationship might be. So unless we challenge that, that come what may, hitting each other, causing violence to each other, is not acceptable in the same manner as it is not acceptable in the public sphere. So, any other parting thoughts on this subject?
Ma'am, long back I wrote in 2006 a presentation for people. The concept of difference in Western society and Eastern societies. And it was related to about the concept of shame.
Mm-hmm.
So when you talked about the dichotomy, right? Because people are afraid of the shaming in public, so they don't do it. And in private, the same people are doing it because there is no outside concept. Our view of most of our people is outward view, not the inward, like how I'm going to be treated in my own eyes.
Mm-hmm.
So if I steal, if nobody sees, that is fine. So if I do domestic violence at home and nobody sees, it's fine, right? But if the thing, if I do
No. Who is this nobody? The person who's subjected to is somebody, na? But we think that people in my house are nobody. That's where the problem is. That they are also somebody is not what we want to recognize and accept. That they're also somebody.
Ma'am, even stealing. So I'm saying that there is nobody and you are stealing, right? The value system that we are inculcating is right. That if nobody is seeing it, it's fine. So some kind of moral values and which over a period of time, which were there, are taken away by consumerism or capitalism. That's my thought process in a fast-moving world.
Have you come across, now, I want all of us to reflect on our lives, the way we've been brought up. At any point of time, did your parent or your relatives or your teachers total, teachers excluded, your family members, immediate or extended family members, how many occasions you came across when they said, don't do this because this is against the law? And especially boys, when you were about 16, 17, and you wanted to drive, how many of your parents said, no, you're not permitted because it is against the law? When you boarded a bus, how many of your friends said, no, no, you must buy a ticket. Not taking the ticket is against the law. Have you come across that incident ever in our life?
Yes, ma'am.
How many
of us? The driving part.
Uh-huh. Your responsible parents?
Though I knew driving, but I was not allowed to drive on roads.
Right. Yeah. Exceptional parents, very good parents. I was in Paris with an American friend who had a small daughter of 5 years old. So she bought the tickets for all of us and she gave the ticket to the small 5 year old. You know, when that man comes, you must show this ticket to him. And she said, why I should show this to the 5 year old? This mother says, because that's the law. And I said, wow, I've never heard anybody in India say that you must buy the ticket. And when the 5 year old, you know, we're very well known for telling our 3+ children that when we're on a bus or, you know, where their ticket will now start being charged, to say, oh, you, when this person asks, how old are you? We'll say, I'm 2.5 or something. We teach them to tell a lie. And I remember when earlier the bus tickets used to be half the rate. Till certain point, it was not, I think till 3 years, there was no charge. Then from 3 years to 12 years, it was half the ticket for children. And so many parents will come across on the buses who are telling their children to tell the conductor that you're only 11 years old. No, don't tell this to that man because you still want to that little money out there. And we've been brought up with that kind of practice. And I was quite taken aback in England. I was on a very sunny day on a Sunday evening around a stream of, there was a stream right by and there were a lot of people who were sitting there. So there was a child who was chasing the ducks who were walking on the sides. And the mother came stopping. No, you can't chase the birds because they have a right to walk on this grass. I mean, it's like 2.5 year being told that. I remember that if I was that mother, I would be chasing the ducks myself also along with the child. This is what we did in our childhood, that a child is doing something and we will also, you know, shoo the birds away. But here was this mother who said, no, you cannot do that. They have a right to walk on this place. So for me, there was lots of things that some things have to change in the way we are brought up and the way we live our lives. How many times you have jumped red lights because nobody is watching? You don't think twice about it. How many times we overspeed? We do everything and we are very happy by doing all that because we were not caught. So this is the category of practices which are prohibited by law. But when they are not prohibited by law, the law hasn't dealt with those issues to challenge ourselves to say, no, I need to learn to be civil in all spheres of my interaction. Whether I'm at a public sphere, whether I'm a student, whether I'm a teacher, whether I'm a man, whether I'm a woman, all spheres of my operation have to be civil. which means no violence. You're not going to change much by making the laws. So what we are struggling with is that many areas we don't have even laws, but even when we do have the laws, we have this whole mindset to find ways and means to thwart the law. And as lawyers, we are doing no better. We do find, and because when there is a language, there's always a possibility of finding a loophole. And what we teach, what we learn as lawyers, prospective lawyers and law students and teachers, is to find and find ways and means to serve the interests of my client. But do I have a social duty in trying to be officer of the court? I'm as much responsible citizen as I am a lawyer of the client. Or the other question one has to think about in determining as to how I'm going to use the law, or the absence of law for that matter. How, what kind of contribution I can make as a practicing lawyer in improving the conditions of people, not only my client. I think these are questions one has to think about. So anyone who wants to have a last word? We need to close. So think about this. Tomorrow, what I'm planning to do, we do not have any reading, nothing, but we will reflect in the sense that I'm going to ask you to identify a couple of things which you think have been something, you know, what we say, oh, wow moment for you in this course, if at all there was anything. But in any case, even if not a wow movement, something which struck you, which you thought, you know, was a new learning for you in this course, we're going to recapitulate that from the beginning of the course till now. So look at your course on the course structure, the course content. Look at every reading, everything, what we have, you know, subtopics, etc. And try and identify for yourself what is it which has been a new learning for you in this course. So we're going to go across everybody tomorrow, whoever joins us, and try to capture the essence of what we have learned in this course. Is that okay? Is that a good plan,
ma'am,
or do we have any alternative plan?
Mom, it's yes, good, ma'am.
Okay, so we'll do that tomorrow.
Thank you.
Ma'am, I also wanted to ask about the pattern of questions which we'll have in the exam.
I do not know whether we're going to have an exam. But as of now, what we are thinking, what we are hearing is that there may not be any exam for the first year and second year. There will certainly be an exam for, you know, you may have it some other stage. And I'll see if we can find some question paper from the previous years. If I find it, I'll post it to you.
Okay, ma'am.
As and when the exam happens. Immediate vicinity, I'm not seeing an exam happening.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, so it might be that, no, you might be have some, I don't know when they'll be scheduled, because at this point of time, we've got just no idea, no conversation on when and what the exam will be. We know it will be from this course, and with the same pattern, 8 questions and do any 5. There'll be some hypothetical, some theory questions. Similar pattern, nothing different in this course.
Okay. Thank you.
Right, see you tomorrow then.